The Word of God is light and life, which brings a wonderful transformation to everything that comes into contact with it. That is why Euro Impact Ministries International seeks to impact the world with Christ, bringing love, purpose, and pursuit into life today. Stay tuned as Pastor Apea Wayao, an anointed servant of God to our generation, delves into the Word of God.
Amen. So, spoken about a lot, spoken about the root cause, spoken about so many things. We said it all boils down to self, pride. And we learned that timidity is pride. Scripture says that God has not given us the spirit of fear. The word there, fear, is timidity. If you have the NIV or any other translation, you see the word timidity. God has not given us the spirit of fear or timidity, but the spirit of boldness, or the spirit of power, of love, and of a sound mind. Amen. So timidity is not of God. It's demonic. It's demonic. It's not from God. Don't ever glory in timidity. It's not from God. God wants his children to speak out. He wants his children to voice out. He wants his children to be bold. He wants his children to be able to correct, to build, edify, instruct. He wants his children to be encouraging. Not, they have something to say, but they are afraid to say not. Doesn't want that one. Not, not. Tell the people, not, not, not. Yeah. So timidity is not of God. Timidity is a proof that the devil has something in you. Because Jesus Christ said, here comes the devil, and he has nothing in me. If timidity is in you, the devil has something to use you with. Don't be timid. Never be timid. I listened to Pastor Chris one time. He said, when he was young, he was super shy. So full of fear. Sometimes they'll ask a question in class, and people will raise up their hand. He even knows better than them. And he was afraid to raise up his hand, so they thought he was not intelligent. And nobody gave him any advantage or called him for anything, because he will not speak out what he knows. When you shut up with your intelligence, you won't get promotion. When they called Joseph from the prison, he said, okay, let me tell you the meaning of your dream. He was not shy. He was not timid. He boldly told the king and advised the king. May God give you the boldness to advise kings. When he finished advising, do you know that if he had only explained the dream and shut up, they would have felt he couldn't handle the economy. When he finished explaining the dream, he said, let me tell you what to do. You should get people who have wisdom so that they will store food for 7 good years. So that in the lean season of 7, the plenty would take care of the dry period. He said, wow, Charlie, there's no wise person like you. Do it. Sometimes you may be qualified, but timidity can disqualify you. It's true. Many people are not promoted. Some of you here could have been SLC president or Nook's president, because you have great ideas. You have great things you could have used to affect the campus. Are you listening? You are afraid. Yet, who's your room now? No roommate. And a school way there. And a school way there. Are you afraid to contest? You are angry about the issue, but you are doing nothing about it. That's hypocrisy. If you're angry about it, do something. Praise the Lord. How many of you are enjoying the Presbyterian church service? I think it's powerful. Amen. The Pastor Rita has been there before. Next hour, come with the rope. Amen. So from there, we spoke also about righteous and unrighteous anger. And last week, I explained to you that anger is good. If you are not angry, it's a sign that you are not going anywhere. You must be angry in life if you'll be a great achiever. Because anger is a sign of passion. It's a sign that you want to see change in something. If you don't get angry, you don't have enough energy. That is why an angry man in the negative way can take stone and kill. Because the anger gives him the energy. It takes away the fear. It takes away everything. With anger, You can even die for Christianity. How many of you agree with me? Some of us will run away because we are not angry enough. Sometimes when you are, enough is enough. Kill me. I will say the truth. You see, passionate people are angry people. That's why God is angry almost all the time. If you study throughout the Old Testament. Today I just typed the word anger. I was amazed. More than half was said by God. And the anger of the Lord and the wrath of the Lord. If anger is sin, God lives in sin. Amen. So last week we looked at importance of anger. And I even told you that in Romans, in Ephesians, scriptures teaches us that we should be angry and sin not. Then he says we should not allow the sun to go down on our anger. What that simply means is that get angry, even in the night, still get angry. They wrongly taught us that when you are angry and it is getting to the night, forgive. That's Sunday school. And some preachers still believe that. That's not what the Bible says. Bible says, be angry and sin not. Don't let the sun go down on your anger. It means let your anger always keep shining. That's what it means. Now, if I say don't let the sun go down on your love for me, it means keep loving me. What do you say? What do you think? Why is that when it came to anger, we think it means when it's 6 o'clock? I mean, like, I would prefer to get angry from morning. Because if you get angry 5:55, it's no good. But you have only 5 minutes to get angry. It doesn't mean that. Bible says, don't let the sun go down on your anger. It means let your anger always be on. That's what it really means. Because he had instructed you earlier. Be angry. That was the instruction. Can we look at that scripture again? Ephesians 4:26. I told you last week that the reason why some of your prayers are not answered is because you are not angry. Sometimes you have to come to a place where you are just tired and angry. Then you begin to see change. I've seen that always cool and calm Christians don't go far. No wonder the scripture says that since the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom suffered violence. And violent, angry people, they are those who can lay hold of the kingdom. You can't be cool and calm in the kingdom because the devil is wicked. You see, the devil can't see who you are on the inside. If you don't scare him on the outside, he will scare you. How many of you have realized that always, all the time, when demons manifest themselves, they talk like, you can't do anything. You don't see what I'll do. You know, they want to scare you. You have to tell them, shut up and go. You need anger to do that. Anger is a sign of your faith. Praise the Lord. You see, when you can't get angry, it means that your opponent is stronger. That's why when a big person slaps you, you want to get angry, but if you get angry and retaliate, the person will finish you. Anger is for the strong. How many of us are strong here? If you know you are not strong, you don't try and get angry. Because what will your anger do? It will cause you more trouble. That's why when somebody beats you on the outside and you go and tell your father or your big brother, say, oh, whatever, you know, he feels he can beat the person. If only he knew the kind of person who beats you. Amen. Amen. Okay. So, where's who read that? Okay, enough is enough. Continue. Be ye angry and sin not. Let not the sun, an instruction, let not the sun go down on your anger. Amen. Be, can you see the word there? It's an instruction. Be angry. But it says don't sin. It means when you are angry without the element of sin, it's a good anger. Be angry and sin not. I'm serious. Let me tell you something. When I was even, I've learned this several times, but when I was teaching this, I realized that some of you, the reason why there is poverty in your family is that you are not angry enough. You are not angry at poverty enough. You fellowship with poverty. You compromise. And you say, then you see. But when you get angry that Jesus became poor for me to become rich, devil, you can't torment my family with anger. Then you can fight. What do you think? Yeah. You got to be angry. Amen. There are two things I told you last week. There are two words that express passion in the Bible. Hunger and anger. Hunger is a picture of passion. Anger is a picture of passion. It was the anger of Moses that was proof enough that he was going to save Israel. Amen? Yeah. Look at Moses' anger. He was angry enough to kill anybody who touched the Israelites. Can you be angry enough to kill? Let me tell you something. Some of you are behaving cool and calm. But imagine there were no soldiers in Ghana who were ready to shoot and kill for your sake and for the sake of the country. Do you know what would have happened to this country? Armed robbers would have finished all of us. But because there are people who have to put their life on the risk. And do you know how they do it? By killing others for you. That's passion. Amen. Amen. You see, there are a lot of people who had, you know, the Bible was translated by people, right? And some of them brought in their thoughts, okay, just to, in other words, their understanding of the scripture, okay? Like if you read the Amplified Version, yes, there are a lot of, into brackets, it's the person's understanding of the word as he or she studied in the Greek or Hebrew or whatever, and then the person puts it there. So it's more of a compounded thing. But what I want you to know, I want to repeat it again. That scripture doesn't mean that when it's getting to six, stop your anger. There is no sense in it. What do you think? So what about if you get angry at 9 p.m.? There's no sense in that. So it doesn't mean that. It means rather the opposite. Don't let the sun go down on your anger. In any language, who is a good English student here? Prof, you're a good English. When I say don't let the sun go down on your love, what does it mean? Okay. 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 Go down. That's it. Thank you. So that's a grammar there. That's it. Oh, but you, that's the meaning. Now, let me tell you something. Why I support this is that it is the meaning that makes sense. Because the other meaning doesn't make sense. What do you mean by, if the sun is going down, I should stop getting angry? So what about if the sun has gotten down before I got angry? I should wait till morning. Listen. Listen, the reality is that unrighteous anger should be killed immediately. You should have the ability that something happened and you are angry at your brother. If you want to wait for the sun to go down before you, that anger will die off, or you have given that anger that lifespan, you know what you can, the harm you can cause before it goes, if it is an unrighteous anger. Do you understand what I'm saying? For example, my sister has offended me. Do you know what I can do to her before the sun goes down? So why wait till then? God says I shouldn't even be angry at all at my sister. In that sense, do you understand me? So this is not referring to that negative anger, that be angry and keep the anger till the sun wants to go down. It doesn't make sense. God doesn't want us angry at one another. It's not good to be angry at your brother or sister. So when you are angry at your brother or sister, immediately, anger is like offense. When you're offended because of what someone, the Bible teaches you, forgive. Peter asked, how many times should I forgive? He said 77 times 7 in a day. Because what causes unrighteous anger is offenses. What the person did to you. It has to do with self. Are you with me? And you are not supposed to keep it even 1 second. So that one, it has nothing to do with time. Do you understand me? Are we students? Yes. So thank you for understanding. So today I want to look at quickly unrighteous anger. Write this in down. This is anger which is self-centered. It's focused on me. Everybody say me. She said this to me. She insulted me. The way he was laughing at me. Yeah. That's the source of that anger. Me. Self-centeredness. He said, I am a fool. That's a problem. He shouted at me. That's why I'm angry. That anger always is rooted in you. It's self-centered. Amen. Amen. How many of you have had this experience where you were correcting somebody? And when you were correcting the person rather got offended. How many of you have had that experience? That's why that anger is not good. It's selfishness. Sometimes you don't know how to deal with some people because it's so strange. They are doing the wrong thing and they still don't expect you to say what you did is wrong. So what should I say? Oh, you are doing fine. It's like, why are you telling me I did this? You did it, yes. You see, the accounts have a proverb which is so intelligent. They said, the one who is... Hey, I'm coaching. You see, they said, the old child crying on him said, hey. So in life... Amen. Hallelujah. So in life, you need correction. Do you know that when the Bible spoke in, somebody can search out in Timothy about the use of the word of God. I think it's 1 Timothy 3:16 or 2 Timothy 3:16. It says it's good for instruction, for rebuke, for correction, for exhortation. Out of the four, three of them has to do it. I mean, in all, you can say they are all corrections. Is it there? Is it 1 Timothy 3:16 or 2 Timothy 3:16, 15 there about? Where is it? 2 Timothy. What does it say? Give me King James. I prefer King James. Read the King James for me. Listen. It's profitable for doctrine. For reproof. Reproof is like a chew in him. For reproof. For correction. For instruction. So three out of four. One is doctrine. Correction. Reproof. And what? Instruction. All this has to do with telling you to do something. Or telling you you did something wrong. Are you with me? Yet. What the people in church hate the most is correction. They don't want you to tell them, now, why did you do the thing this way when you were asked to do it this way? They don't want any willful. So all that I'm doing, it can't be seen. Selfishness. Don't you realize that when you are doing good, you are the one I should correct? Because when you are doing good, you are the one who can do better. And if you are doing better, you are the one who can become the best. And I keep saying this, if I have 5 oranges and 1 apple, and I want a perfect number of oranges, I don't need to add more oranges. I just need to take off 1 apple and you'll be perfect. One over one is excellence. 9/10 is not. So even if it is one thing you can do or one thing that you have and the negatives are taken off, you are better. Are you with me? You are better. Yet we want to add on more talent and not remove the things that will hinder us rather. Do you know that one granite can change the taste of 100 granites in your mouth? One, only one, one single. Sometimes not even full one. Most of the time, the ones that spoil everything, they are not matured. They are some dry granite. Why you have that experience? Amen. Sometimes something small, Bible says a dead fly, just a fly, can spoil the sweet smell of the perfume. That's what Proverbs said. Just something little. So the Solomon said, the little foxes. Are you with me? So when you are corrected, they are doing you more good. When you are being helped to come out of a particular character, attitude, something you keep doing, the person is offering you more help. Bible says that the children who God loves, he chastises, he punishes, he disciplines. You think I'll be doing you good when you sleep out, seven, eight. You are programming yourself for failure in the midst of grace. Are you with me? Yet, we hate correction. Do you know why? Because of unrighteous anger. Pride is in us. And that's why sometimes even those who have to correct you, they fear to correct you. Mike Mundog said, a mentor is not the one who tells you what you are doing right. He's the one who tells you what you are doing wrong. Your mentor is not for your comfort. He's for your future. That if he has to beat you for your future to be well, he'll beat you today for your... That's why some of you, God is beating you today and you are crying. But it's for your future. Because if he doesn't discipline you in your youth, you'll become a womanizer by 40. And yet you hate it when you are corrected. Unrighteous. It's called unrighteous anger. May God give us a heart. Let me tell you something. Every day you are corrected, say thank you. Because let me tell you something. Sometimes you can't see what you are doing wrong. You don't know what you are doing wrong. So for you to get somebody who have the strength and the boldness to love you enough, the person who tells you you are looking good doesn't love you as much as the person who tells you what you are doing wrong. I'm telling you. Ah, if you say I'm looking good and I'm truly looking good, would that affect me negatively or positively? Nothing. But if something is wrong with me and you don't tell me, that is what can cause me harm in the future. But because of selfishness and pride, now people can't be corrected, because even pastor is afraid when he corrects you, you get angry. Amen. Do you have so much on? There are some people, after you finish correcting them, they'll just stand there because, you know, you are there, so they can't talk. Okay. When they go back, this pastor is ungrateful. So all I'm doing, this small thing, is it only me who has done that? Is it only me? This is the reason why most of the time servants and slaves do better than sons and daughters. A slave can work from morning to evening. He has no choice. But you know what? You may think it's punishment, but it's development. She has built a capacity. Some of you can't even take 1 meal a day. You will die. You have to eat 3 times, 4 times plus snack. And that's why some of you, right from a young age, you just started working. They gave you 1,005, 1,002. You can't handle it because you had never trained. You're never trained. Always it looks like people who go through the punishment and the suffering and the everything. Do you know that they said children, medically, children who don't get the opportunity to play during their childhood and get hurt and roll up and down and do all those things, they grow up and their mind is not developed. Yes. It's a medical said that proved it. Amen. That's why I'm telling you, some of you here, there are children on the street at the age of 11, 12, they know economics more than you. They know how to manage money more than you, Pastor Phil and Co, who have done agribusiness. I'm telling you. For the communication people there, they know they don't know how to handle money. my spiritual father's wife, she completed secondary school. She didn't continue. Listen, she knows money. She knows how to handle money. She started with another sister. They started on the table selling at Accra. Now the lady she was working with has 4 shops. If it was some of us, it'd be this kind of crime, I say. And so we have gone to school and learned all the curves. Because you've not been through anything. So even the books cannot change you. That is why every soldier with a great general, something, you see scars. The battles you have fought to decide the crowns you have. Some of us hate discipline. You hate discipline. You just dislike it. Then your eyes become red. Only for telling you that what you did was wrong. Hey, this thing you are doing will not help you. You wish there was no rule over you. There are those who preach, I don't believe in fatherhood. Continue like that. Be a vagabond. When your time of dying comes, we'll come and bury you. And most of the time, do you know why they don't want fathers? They don't want anyone to tell them, you are rushing. Slow down. You are rushing. Take your time. That thing is not going to work this way. Let me tell you something. When you are a youth, you think irrationally. It is only youth who wants to build the 4 mansions in Accra at the age of 25 with an employment of 1,005. What is wrong with you? Youth, no patience. Let me tell you something. If many youth were patient, last time I was telling you, if many of us were patient, we wouldn't have rushed into things. We would have stayed focused on our destiny. Would have stayed focused on our destiny and not rushed. But we are not patient. And most of the times, there is no rule. There is no guide. Because of that, some of you, the things you are doing, you wouldn't want even your pastor to know. Because if he knows, you don't want anybody to come and tell you, why are you doing this? I told you a story one time. A sister of mine here, she was working together with me here on campus. I got to know a guy, he was dating the guy. No, you know, sometimes ladies, I don't know why they can't see. I mean, it was so obvious this guy will not help you. I went to this lady, explained. Do you understand? I said everything. I didn't even shout. I was so kind and nice. The following day, the lady said, I want to see you. I mean, on campus, go, Appear, I want to see you. I said, okay, fine. Where should I meet you? I met her. I was like, I don't want to be part of the ministry again. I don't even want the position again. I said, why? She said, I don't like people intruding my private affairs. I said, oh, I didn't mean that. Oh, I have to speak. I'm sorry. Oh, so you carry it back for the position. I won't take it from you. Go back. I said, I'm sorry. She went back. 2 weeks after, she said, Abia, what has happened? Me, I've even forgotten about the relationship. I've left him. I said, what happened? He said, the guy, I started noticing this, so I've left him. I said, we thank God. You know, I could have said, let me catch you. But I said, church member. You know, sometimes when I see some of you treat young souls the way you treat them, I know you are not a shepherd, you are a wolf. You don't have a heart of a shepherd. Because I could have said, let me catch you. But I felt like, hey, create another offense. Charlie, cool down. Yes, handle it. You know, some of you don't know the difference between this one is mature, this one just came in. Somebody came into the ministry 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks. One man, they will say, why did you? How dare you? As you talk to the person, like, I will slap you on top. Because that's a soul you are trying to mature. Relax for the person. It's not giddy giddy like that. Oh. Great shepherd Jacob said to Esau, he said, oh, you take the lead and go with your men. You came with men and horses. But I am with children and with animals with their young. We will come little by little. We will get there. That's a shepherd. I'm not in a rush. Are you with me? I'm saying all this to talk to you about the root cause. Why some of you, your anger is unnecessary. Let me tell you, even some of the things you got angry about, you knew it was true. Sometimes you tried, I know it was true, but I just didn't like how it was said. Listen, I've learned from experience, no matter how nice sometimes the person says it, you will still get angry anyway. Because it has nothing to do with how it is said. But the fact that somebody says, you are wrong, me wrong, how could I be wrong? Praise the Lord. How many of us are humble here?
Thanks for listening to God's Word. If you were blessed by this message and want to make Jesus the Lord over your life, pray this simple prayer with me. Lord Jesus, thank you for your love. I confess with my mouth and believe in my heart that you died on the cross and rose again for me. Thank you for being the Lord over my life, this day and forever. I am grateful for your joy and peace that fills my life. Amen. To know more about Euro Impact Ministries International, contact 0247-014-717 or 0209-026-848.